I want to issue a trigger warning before this video begins. The following video is not about MGTOW or the men's rights movement. It deals with the concept of morality and contains some religion bashing. You've been trigger warned. Nihilism is a word often used by pseudo-intellectuals to call someone immoral. The reason for this is the idea that a nihilist is a person that does not believe in objective morality. And if you do not believe in morality, you are immoral. The first problem is the assumption that a nihilist believes there is no morality. And while a nihilist could believe that, they could also believe there is morality, but it is not objective, but rather subjective. Many people will point to Nietzsche and proclaim that he was the great philosopher of nihilism. However, Nietzsche was actually an existentialist, who merely wrote about nihilism often. I had a Tradkin a month or so ago tell me that MGTOW were nihilists. The man's explanation of why involved one scenario which would have equated to idealist and another example which would have translated to defeatist or possibly pessimist. Not that either of those two examples he gave was even valid. What gets me is when these traditionalist conservatives call me a nihilist. I don't really know how to respond to that, because I am a nihilist, but they just don't know what the word means. Calling me a nihilist is like calling me an atheist. It's true. But I fail to see the problem. Morality. What is it? The simplest way of looking at it is the dictionary definitions. 1. Principles concerning the distinction between right and wrong or good and bad behavior. 2. A particular system of values and principles of conduct, especially one held by a specified person or society. So morality is all about good and bad behavior. But what is good? What is bad? Where does it come from? What makes it universally true? Well, for starters, it's not universally true. If it were universally true, there'd be no war, no fighting, no arguments, one religion, and no politics. If we could all agree on universal good and bad, and agree that it's good to be good, and bad to be bad, we'd have peace on earth. Morality is typically backed by the belief in a god. God whispers in the ear of some people out in the fucking desert. Guy in the desert stands before a crowd yelling, "Hear ye, hear ye. God has spoken unto me, and this is what he wants you to do." And if he tells just enough feel-good lies, people follow him, and a cult is started. Cults jockey for power. One of them eventually becomes mainstream, and we have ourselves a religion. Again, if you're looking for God, grab a camel and head to the desert where no one is around, because that's when God feels the need to whisper his wisdom into people's ear, rather than hijacking television and radio to announce his desires to the world, or talking to all humans at the same time, thereby actually establishing his existence as factual rather than what the sweaty guy on the camel claims. Because apparently God's an asshole and thinks whispering into the ears of a select few from time to time, giving them contradicting statements, and watching countless billions of humans suffer and fight over him for thousands of years, would be fucking hilarious. So morality, that is to say good and bad, is backed up by make-believe. Okay, since the authority for morality is make-believe, then so is morality, but that's too simple. Even without using God as the authority of morality, the compulsion to see some behavior as good and some behavior as bad still persists in humans. If we have a tendency, and this includes atheists, then morality is not the outcome of a fiction. We can deduce that the belief in some things being good and bad is an inborn tendency. The problem is, if it were inborn, we'd see a whole lot of consistency. Unfortunately, we don't see a whole lot of consistency. We see never-ending arguing over right and wrong. I proclaim the notion, keyword, notion, that a such thing as right and wrong even exists, is a human instinct. The determination of right and wrong is more circumstantial, cultural, than evolutionary programming. Killing, is it right or wrong? Well, there is most certainly some rule against it in all cultures, and it's probably the greatest example of the ultimate wrong. However, we kill roaches and see this as good. We kill cows and eat them and see it as good. We kill germs and think it's good. So to be more specific, it is wrong to kill people. Okay, why are humans more entitled to life than germs, bugs, and animals? Because we humans are selfish, self-absorbed, self-centered, narcissistic assholes who strut around thinking we're better than any other life form. That's not a joke, I am serious. And I, for one, agree with this mentality. I have a right to kill a cow and eat it. You do not have the right to kill me and eat me. Why? Because I'm special, damn it. That's another one. Selfishness is bad, except when it benefits you. You and a few co-workers are feeling froggy. You know it's time someone be given a raise. You know there are only so many raises that are going to be given. So you show up extra bright and early, make your way into the boss's office and ask for a raise. You get the raise before anyone else even bothered asking. You selfish prick. But you're not selfish. You were entitled to that raise over the others because, insert whatever bullshit helps you sleep at night. Lying, that's another big no-no. Lying is immoral, except when you do it to evade punishment, then you're totally willing to overlook that shit. Back to killing. Humans should not kill humans. Killing animals and germs and plants, that's fine, but not other humans. I think we can all agree on this. However, when a police officer shoots an armed criminal that was running away, we tend to overlook this in many cases because if he was armed while fleeing, then it's only a matter of time before he would have grabbed a hostage, and more lives would be at stake. So long as he is armed and fleeing, he is a danger to everyone he comes into contact with. Therefore, killing him now will save people. Running him off the road now might save him from slamming into a minivan with an entire family. Of course, you'll always have that ghetto bitch on the news screaming that cop shouldn't have shot that person. We can say the difference here is, you violated his right to live because he posed a threat to the right of life of others. And that is what makes the exception. What about a man that already committed a crime, and is no longer a threat to anyone? Because of a crime he committed in the past, we give him the death penalty. We killed a man who killed a man, and has no more intention of killing anyone else. And people disagree with the death penalty. But if morality were universal, and was anything beyond people's capricious opinions of what we ought and ought not be doing, wouldn't we get some consensus on whether or not the death penalty is good or bad? Funny thing is, if you round up all the people who support the death penalty, accused them of a heinous crime, found them guilty, put them on death row, I bet they'd be changing their tune about the death penalty when their selfish, self-serving ass was on the line. And how many people against the death penalty would scream, "Kill him, kill him!" when the man that raped and killed their children was found and made a full confession, laughing and bragging about the way he raped, tortured, killed and ate them, and how he looks forward to doing it again when he gets out? What if a person is in pain, has no practical means to kill themselves and wants someone else to do it? Is assisted suicide bad? Well, it's illegal. But is it bad? If we agree it is bad, but say that it is bad because it is illegal, then we are stating a law, no matter how ridiculous, is a good thing. If the law said you must shoot someone in the head for running a red light, is it now immoral to let them live? Is it now moral to kill them? Wouldn't this contradict the idea that killing humans is wrong to begin with? If we say assisted suicide is just wrong because human life is sacred, I would then argue that allowing someone to suffer is wrong. Allowing a person to suffer when they do not wish to suffer is akin to inducing the suffering. But if I said that and meant it, I would now have just obligated you to feed every hungry hobo. Perhaps some people would say you should be forced to pay taxes to feed all hungry hobos. Well then, by the same logic, all horny men who suffer sexual frustration are entitled to blowjobs. I do recall actually using this argument on some cunt that supported socialism. "Oh, it is so immoral, so inhumane to let a man starve," she said. "Surely a moral person would agree establishing a law guaranteeing his right to food would be the moral thing." Okay. And certainly a 40-year-old virgin never knowing the pleasure of intimacy with a woman is suffering, and it would be immoral to not obligate women to fuck him. Same argument, but this socialist cunt couldn't accept that it was the same argument. I even used this argument if a person with spare money in their pocket walks past a hungry hobo, is it immoral to not give some money to the hobo? To which she said yes. I then said if you walk past some lonely old loser who is dying for sexual contact, is it immoral to not give him some kind of sexual favor? Especially considering you can give an infinite amount of sexual favors. I happen to have a limit to how much money I can give. And again, I am told the scenarios are different, but not told what the logical, rational difference is. Is suicide immoral? Well, we have a law against it, but is it immoral? I have heard often that suicide is immoral because it's a thing you shouldn't do, and a person who wants to do it is not in their right mind. Well then, is it moral for us to hold dominion over someone else's body, and force their continued existence against their will? Should humans and the right to their own life be property of their community? How do we establish a person to not be in their right mind? Apparently we make this proclamation anytime someone behaves against our wishes. It's an excellent way of removing them from their autonomy. So either we have control over the life of an individual, or an individual has control over his own life. We cannot say you are an individual sentient being with a right to live, but not a right to die. If we say it is moral to give them the right of self-determination, we cannot then say it is right to take away that self-determination when we disprove of the self-determined behaviors. Furthermore, you cannot have a right to life if you have not a right to death. Likewise, you cannot have the right of prosperity if you have not the right of self-destruction. You cannot have freedom of religion if you don't also have the freedom from it. You cannot guarantee the right of the people freedom of speech unless you equally grant them the right to listen. Now I realize I am conflating rights with morals. But aren't these very basic rights based on the notion that issuing the right itself is a moral obligation? What I mean is, your right to religious expression is not immoral, it's a right. But wouldn't a government not granting such a right, or depriving you of this right, be immorality? The idea behind the US Constitution was, these are rights you already have by virtue that any effort to deprive you of these following rights would be despicable, immoral, and inhumane. I declare loudly here and now that your right to suicide is a constitutionally protected right. The US government is sworn to uphold your naturally occurring rights, which includes, in the Constitution, your right to life. You have no right to life if you have no right to end it. If it's not yours to end, then it's not yours at all. Thus it is someone else who has the right to your life, and therefore you are deprived of your right. Yet we live in a society that tells me suicide is immoral. But again, if it is immoral to take away a person's right to life, then forbidding their suicide is thereby denying their right to life, which is immoral. And with that example, does one immorality cancel another immorality? Is this shit hierarchical now? If so, which morality takes priority and what is the deciding factor? Are we going to go back to the flawed assumption that popular consensus is somehow a deciding factor in a morality that we call objective? Abortion is a moral topic split down the middle. The argument here is, killing a fetus is killing a human, thus murder, a thing we constantly say is immoral and then making so many fucking exceptions for. But the other side of that coin is, removing a woman of her bodily autonomy and forcing a condition to happen upon her which will cause her physical and emotional distress, is immoral. But then remember, allowing a person to suffer and removing bodily autonomy from them by not allowing suicide or assisted suicide is the moral thing to do because life is sacred, or some bullshit. We typically agree that forced sterilization is wrong, and infringes upon people's right of self-ownership. However, what if the mother has HIV and her babies will be born AIDS babies? Better to sterilize her now than for little AIDS babies to be born and suffer. Unless bringing AIDS babies into this world to suffer and die is a totally moral thing to do. Is it the moral thing to do, if I have a baby, and decide to splash acid on it to burn and scar it, just for shits and giggles, I have no doubt I would be called immoral. But if I had AIDS and got knocked up and decided to have an AIDS baby, just because I want to, how is this not equally immoral? And is it immoral to prevent someone from committing an act of immorality? For example, if you knew of my plan to dip my baby in acid, would you then violate my property rights by coming onto my property, commit theft and human abduction by taking away my kids, and then proceed to take away my freedom and autonomy by locking me up in prison for my attempt to torture and possibly kill an infant? And if you agree you have the right to violate my property and person to prevent me from committing an act of immorality, then how is it immoral to sterilize a person with AIDS? Does the needs of the many outweigh the needs of the few? For example, if one individual in a high population density area such as New York City, New York, had a rare and ultra-contagious disease, possibly because he got pricked with a needle full of this genetically modified supervirus, would it be immoral to detain him, forbidding him to leave work, and holding him in an isolated facility for the rest of his short life? Is it moral? Immoral? After all, you are depriving him of his freedom, and he committed no crime. If you answer that it would be immoral, then you are saying it's okay for him to leave the facility and spread a contagious virus which could easily have the catastrophic effect of contaminating and killing countless millions. But if we agree that containing this one individual is good, then we can extend this and ask, is quarantining 1,000 to save 5,000 people still moral? What about containing 2,000 to save 3,000? What about 2,500 to save 2,500? Or what about the minority? What if you had to quarantine 3,000 people to save only 2,000? You'd be inconveniencing the majority for the benefit of the minority. But at the same time, is it fair to impose a diseased group of people onto a non-diseased people? Wouldn't it be immoral of the infected people to even want to expose themselves to uninfected people? Is it not a moral obligation to prevent people from committing immoral acts? If we agree to this, then why shouldn't people be forced to hand over taxes to feed the starving minority? But if we agree to that, back to should people be forced to give sex to the sexually frustrated? And then there is the argument that you have a right to your belongings and shouldn't have it taken from you, even for the good of others. And is this still true when the good of others become the majority? Is it immoral for an adult to have sex with a 13-year-old? Well, the general consensus is that it is an unbelievably heinous crime. Yes, adults marrying 13-year-olds and younger throughout most of human history was pretty fucking common. It has only very recently in human history, and only in most cultures, become taboo and illegal. How is it that humanity spent 99% of its existence committing an act of immorality, claiming it was not immoral, and now out of the clear fucking blue it's immoral? If in the future, we return to a cultural trend of allowing 13-year-olds to marry adults, will it just become moral? Will changing the laws make it moral? Will making it culturally fashionable make it moral? If a moral is objective, it must remain true all the time, and not be dependent on arbitrary laws or subject to cultural trends. I recall a scenario where there was a society that had dolls as wives. I thought it was a fascinating article and was reading it when one of the founders of this society spoke about tolerance but then had a zero tolerance policy against allowing men to bring doll wives who were replicas of children. In other words, pedophilia was not tolerated, in spite of the fact this is a group of weirdos who have life-size dolls as wives, in spite of the fact that a doll can neither be a child nor an adult, because it is not a living thing. The logical justification for adults not being able to engage in sex with minors is the idea that minors can't give meaningful consent, but dolls can't fucking give consent either. This got me to ask people online some questions about whether or not they thought sex with minors was moral or immoral, and I would start asking questions like, if I were on a Star Trek holodeck and generated a synthetic child to have sex with, am I being immoral? And most people answered, yes. So from this I can glean that morality isn't even a thing you do, but can be a thing you think or feel. But what if a pedophiles, and just people who like jailbait, are born that way? And let's face it, they are born that way every bit as much as a tranny or a homosexual. It's an instinctive emotional thing they can't help, be it caused by childhood trauma, arrested development, neurology, perhaps perfectly natural, or all the above. But let's say this person with an involuntary desire resists the temptation all of his life. Is he still immoral for the involuntary emotions in his head in spite of the fact he was born that way? Is it moral to dislike, feel prejudice toward, brand as evil, a person who has immoral feelings? Is it moral for a society to judge people by both their feelings and their actions? If I am angered and it makes me emotionally feel like hitting someone, am I an immoral person for the emotion and desire itself? Even though I'm not acting on it, would it be immoral if I just had a dream about doing it? If I punched someone while feeling no anger or resent, is it still immoral? Is morality an action, a thought, or a thought plus action? Is it wrong to force children to go to school from ages 5 to 18, where they will be forced to read bullshit propaganda literature for the majority of those 13 years, forced to sit still, on their butts, on hard plastic chairs, subject to the authoritarian whims of their teachers, bullied by their peers, emotionally pressured and deeply stressed out to succeed, grounded for failing, and having the bulk of their youth robbed from them, all of this against their will? Is this moral? There is something about forcing all of this on a young sentient being, taking away their right to say no, that feels like it is some sort of human violation. But apparently not only is it not a violation, it is the law, and culturally accepted as good, and thus moral. Yet what about a father forcing his daughter into prostitution so the income can save the house, making her sacrifice? A sacrifice for the benefit of the entire family. Yet I'm sure if I asked, is forcing your daughter into prostitution moral, people would say no. But what about the few having to make sacrifices for the many? A few nights of hooking and the whole family gets the benefit of eating and keeping their house. Yet, isn't it immoral for the family to obligate the young lady into committing acts she is uncomfortable with? And if that is true, is it right for parents to send children to school if the child is uncomfortable with school? Does the level of discomfort the child have flipped the switch from moral to immoral? After all, should good just be good, and bad just be bad? No matter how high on the scale the level of discomfort, I've asked, is aborting offspring immoral? But what about, is having offspring immoral? Who here ever uttered the words, oh yeah, well I never asked to be born? Hey, it may not have won you the argument with your parents, but it was a good point. All obligations, disappointments, and heartache, desires and needs unmet, were thrust upon you by an act of birth you never consented to be a part of. If we accept that it is moral to kill plants, germs, bugs, and animals, not that everyone will agree to this, but those who do, is it immoral to kill the last of a few remaining members of a species? What if, for example, we're down to our last 1,000 rhinos? Is it okay to kill them? Or is it immoral knowing that any more deaths will thin their numbers beyond any hope of having enough genetic diversity for healthy procreation, thus committing genocide? If we say killing animals that are plentiful is fine, but then say killing animals on the verge of extinction is wrong, then what is the difference maker? Again, if it's perfectly moral to violate the right to life of one member of a species, what makes it suddenly wrong to violate the existence of the entire species? Is it human selfishness that we just want to keep these pretty animals around to look at? Is our motive to stop them from going extinct just an effort to keep them around for our amusement? Is their right to life dependent on our amusement? After all, we kill them for the pleasure of their meat, which we do not need to live, but feel amused by the taste of their flesh. We kill them to have their skin as clothing for the amusement of how it looks on us. And we'd save them when they are endangered because they look so damn pretty, and we want a continued supply of their meat and flesh for further amusement. Interesting that the right for any life form to exist is dependent upon human amusement, but would we not object to a superior life form taking the same attitude with us? Again, a lot of this morality, comes down to what emotionally satisfies the self-centered egotistical human. But is that even a bad thing? Hasn't this human narcissism kept us alive and brought us to the top of the food chain? And isn't existing and being alive a good thing and thus moral? And what about races of humans? And before I get any of you saying race doesn't really exist, shut up. You know what I mean. What if there was a virus that infected Norway, and pretty soon spread to every Norwegian? And what if, due to the symbiosis and evolution of intestinal flora, all the microbiotic life in our guts that control 71% of our immune system, this virus evolved to live in perfect harmony with the Norwegian people, and laid as an eternally harmless and dormant virus, doing no harm to Norwegians? But what if it were discovered that the Japanese people, due to their ever so slightly different genetics and intestinal flora, all of them that came into contact with those Norwegians, lost their fertility, with no cure, and thus could never have children, when exposed to this virus, brought to them by Norwegians? Would it be intolerant or racist or immoral for Japan, whose people would now be facing extinction, to lock down their borders, forbidding Norwegian immigration? Again, the virus causes no suffering, death, or discomfort, just the inability to breed children. Should the immigration privilege of the Norwegians trump the right to continued survival of the Japanese people? What if the Norwegians offer to have babies on behalf of the Japanese, and then surrender the offspring to the Japanese couple that ordered a baby? The Japanese would still get to be parents, but those children would be tall, round-eyed, pale white Norwegians, not children who look like them and their parents and family. For those of you who say the Japanese have a right to continue life as genetically Japanese people, ending Norwegian immigration privilege for the sake of self-preservation would be a morally justifiable thing for the Japanese. For those of you who say that, I ask, what about all the brown-skinned people pouring into Norway? Should people such as the Middle Eastern Muslims be denied immigration to Norway on the grounds that Norway is becoming so saturated with non-white, non-Norwegians, that pretty soon racial mixing alone will contaminate the genetics of the Norwegians, thereby leading to their extinction? But locking the borders to preserve their genetics is immoral? For those of you who would answer that neither the Norwegians or the Japanese have any right to lock their borders and deprive any group of people their migration privilege, for the purpose of preserving their race, because there just is no such thing as race, for those of you that hold that opinion, I say, okay, but what if I took one race of bear, moved them to another bear territory, so that these two endangered breeds of bear intermated, producing one new racial mixture, at the expense of forever destroying the other two breeds? Any objections? Would this plan of mine be immoral? What if I took all breeds, races, of dog and removed their mating choices to make sure every breed produced offspring with a breed other than its own, thereby forever removing all dog breeds except for one new breed that would come from the racial mixture? Is this immoral? Is telling a lie immoral? Typically we say it is. But is telling a lie to spare someone their feelings immoral? Is telling a lie to save someone's life immoral? Is telling a lie to save your own life immoral? Is telling a lie to avoid getting beat up immoral? Is telling a lie to get out of being spanked immoral? Is telling a lie to get a raise immoral? If any one of those scenarios is immoral, but another is moral, what is the mechanism? What is the basis for the difference? And this mechanism, this exception, must be universally applicable in all other scenarios too, right? Is stealing immoral? Is stealing from a person who stole that item from someone else immoral? If we say it's okay to take something that doesn't belong to you, when that thing also doesn't belong to the person you are stealing from by virtue of the fact they also stole it, then can I embezzle from an insurance company that took my grandmother's monthly payments for decades, yet weasel their way out of paying for her hip replacement, and call it a morally justified act of stealing? Is killing a person who killed a person immoral? Is punching a person for punching a person immoral? If one cannot be justified and the other can, what's the difference maker, and is the difference maker universally applicable? And if both are moral, then can I steal from a company, do harm to the company, that has exploited workers, possibly ruined nations with its exploitation and war profiteering? If it is immoral for me to steal, in all these cases, what about if a comet hits the Earth, kills off everyone, and I am the last human on Earth? Can I walk into a store and take something without paying? If so, this would be an acknowledgement that morality is subjective, not objective. Is homosexuality immoral? The religious right sure thinks so. But is heterosexuality immoral? I want to know why heterosexuality isn't even being brought into question. Although to be fair, sex outside of marriage, in the eyes of some, is immoral. So heterosexuality is by default an immoral act unless it is purified by the ritual of marriage to wash away its immorality. If we were to ask, but why doesn't homosexuality get its purification ritual in the eyes of the religious right, we are told homosexuality is immoral because it is unnatural. Okay, cheese whiz is unnatural. Is cheese whiz immoral? Is eating it immoral? We are told homosexuality is unhealthy. Well, I don't know that it actually is, although the ridiculously high rate of AIDS does lend some credit to this, but the high rate of heart attack from obesity is pretty alarming. So is diabetes from obesity. So is obesity immoral? Should fat people not be protesting gay marriage? Should gays be protesting Dunkin' Donuts to rage war on obesity, which threatens the moral fabric of our society? And I fully understand homosexuality is unnatural. The evolutionary reason for a sex drive is to inspire, lead to, copulation between two sexes of the same species to produce offspring. Sexual desires that cannot lead to offspring are thus unnatural. Okay, I get that, but again, is cheese whiz immoral? People sucking on rescue inhalers is unnatural. Are asthmatics immoral? Wheelchairs are unnatural. Is being in a wheelchair immoral? Voluntary celibacy is unnatural. Does this make Catholic priests immoral? Think about that. A life of voluntary celibacy is unnatural, and is part of the job description, the religious vow undertaken by the priest. Then what we have is a man by virtue of his faith, committing sexual immorality and castigating others for homosexual immorality. Hey, is hypocrisy immoral? If so, Father O'Brien, that's two strikes. If a person strangles someone because they were angry, we say he is evil. If he strangles someone because he was in a car accident and was confused, we remove the label of evil. Because the man in the car accident had his brain temporarily altered by concussion, we remove the label evil. But if he were born with a psychological illness that made him go around strangling people, do we still apply the label of evil? If so, then couldn't it be argued that all acts of immorality come from ignorance and or a genetic predisposition, that is mental illness, and thus all acts of immorality are not evil? I insist evil is not a cause for an action. It is the label given to people for an action. I'm not asking is it legal for a human in any of those three circumstances to strangle. I am asking is it moral, moral here meaning good, or just not evil? If we say in any of the three circumstances, he is not being evil, then motive and circumstance is the mechanism, the deciding factor. If immoral, or evil, is merely a matter of intent, then intention is based upon knowledge of the situation, such as a pet owner giving their dog poison to make it die slowly and painfully, versus a pet owner who gave their dog Tylenol to ease its pain after a broken leg, killed the dog because Tylenol will shut down its liver. We call one evil, and the other ignorant, as in he did not have a proper understanding of the consequences to his action. So if ignorance can justify otherwise evil and immoral behavior, isn't it fair to argue that a person can commit any atrocity so long as they believe the ends will justify the means, simply due to their ignorance of the situation? Is a government's tyranny no longer immoral if the governing body believes that their rule over the people is in the best interest of the people they govern? Is a parent's abuse of their child perfectly moral so long as they themselves are convinced that their abusive actions are warranted discipline for the greater good of their child's development and are committing these horribly abusive acts out of love? If this makes their actions moral, remember, not legal, but moral, then is taking their children away from them immoral? First was the question of is committing an immoral act onto someone as punishment for an immoral act moral? And now in this circumstance I am asking is committing an immoral act, forcibly removing a child from the parent's custody, suddenly moral when the person this immoral act is against is a moral person due to ignorance of their actions? And if not, is allowing the abuse to continue, because the person is too ignorant to raise a child, now an act of morality? I declare that morality is dependent upon both context and perception. If it is dependent on either, it is subjective, not objective. If it is dependent on both, it is extremely subjective, flexible, and downright not really there. Morality is simply any one given person's personal opinion of ought to be and ought not be, and this person will, as human instinct dictates, flip-flop on when they choose to obey their own value system when it is the most advantageous act. That is, there is no such thing as morality, only assholes with opinions who want to preach their bullshit to others. Is it immoral to cast judgment on others? If so, isn't declaring someone to be immoral immoral? I have a deep distrust of people who use morality as an argument for why a thing should or shouldn't be. I find these people to be pompous assholes who have no real argument, and might as well be hiding all of their rationality behind, because God says so, which just comes down to, because I said so, after lots of opinions on is there a God, who is the one true God, and what is the one true interpretation of that one true God. Until all of humanity can universally agree on that, there is no morality. Just assholes with opinions who lack any real logical argument and wish to manipulate others with the illusion of coming from authority. If I wanted to control people, to manipulate them, I would do it first by telling them what I wanted them to do, and how I wanted them to think. And if I were a stupid person who wanted to control and manipulate people, I would tell them what I wanted them to do and what I wanted them to think. And rather than providing a rational, intelligent argument, I would justify the validity, the merit, the legitimacy of my opinion by uttering the words God, nature, morality. Example, we have to do blank, because it's what God would want us to do. We have to do blank, because it's natural. We have to do blank, because it's the moral thing to do. We cannot do blank, because God forbids it. We cannot do blank, because it's unnatural. We cannot do blank, because it's immoral. How about, we must do blank, because it will benefit us in this way and in that way. How about, we must not do blank, because it will harm us in this way or that way. How about actual examples of how any given action, collective decision, or way of thinking, is either beneficial or detrimental to the demographic you're preaching to? Oh, that's right, because you're a fucking moron who's preaching that others conform to your selfish viewpoint because it would emotionally suit you, and you have no real argument besides because it's the way I want things to be. Now I am being a little harsh. Not everyone who has ever used God/nature/morality as an excuse to justify why you should listen to their opinion is stupid or deceitful. Sometimes it can just be a matter of copying the vernacular of the people you are talking to. You have heard an idea, a sentiment, about this is wrong, it is horrifically immoral, and the overwhelming majority of society would agree, strongly and emotionally, so you whip out the catchphrase doing blank would be immoral. This does not make you a manipulative sociopath, and the thing about manipulation is, not all manipulation is bad. For example, you invite me over to your house, I see your soda, and I say hey, I sure am thirsty, can I have a soda? I am manipulating you, I am attempting to get you to part with a soda. This is manipulation. However, it becomes, in my personal opinion, that it is wicked/wrong/evil/immoral when I use deception to manipulate you, such as, hey, I'm diabetic, and I need to get my blood sugar up, can I have a sugary soda? That's a sort of sociopathic manipulation because I am handing you false information, and preying on your sense of guilt and compassion, in order to manipulate you. Even when people do not use deception, but often prey on your sense of guilt, or your need for approval and acceptance, this is sociopathic because they are exploiting your vulnerability. I've always found it fascinating that psychopaths who lack guilt will often use other people's guilt response as a tool to manipulate them. Ironically, this can include calling others immoral or sociopath because you are branding them with a word that represents a person of bad moral character. And why? Because you want to manipulate the way they think and behave. This is rotten behavior on your part and speaks volumes about your own character. Very related to the sociopath is the narcissist, who also has that interesting phenomenon of calling people the very thing in which they, themselves, are. The narcissist will believe, on some level, that all eyes should be on him, all attention, credit, praise, and reward, are owed to him, and anyone not giving this, is being selfish, like a spoiled self-centered narcissist. So, as you can see, I don't buy into this make-believe manipulative bullshit of morality. At least not some universal morality that is applicable to other people. Individuals may have their own value system, and they may or may not break it often, but your personal value system is your personal opinions. Your personal feelings on shit does not dictate reality or justify interfering with other people's decisions by way of reprimanding or vilifying them. I don't know if I even have a personal value system. I have a system of wants, subject to change. I have a standard set of reactions and attitudes, subject to change. I have notions of what is advantageous to myself, what is advantageous to any other given group of people, and ideas on what actually functions in human society. And again, all of this subject to change upon the acquisition of new knowledge. I do not make statements or decisions based on the notion of this being right or wrong, but instead, true or false, and beneficial or detrimental, and pleasing and displeasing. Sometimes these principles conflict, such as, I am watching my favorite show, a large bowl of ice cream would be pleasing. It is true that ice cream is high in fat, calories, and sugar. It is detrimental to my health to partake in the consumption of ice cream. Short-term and long-term health benefit versus short-term and long-term emotional satisfaction. Give a few moments for my unconscious mind to process the short-term emotional benefit versus the long-term detriment, weigh against all other unhealthy decisions made recently, and all other instances of self-control, and conclusion arrives. At no point in time does the notion of the decision being good or evil, right or wrong, moral or immoral play a part in my decision. This begs the question, am I a good person? The answer is in the eye of the beholder. I can be both fun-loving, compassionate, and yet downright a mean-spirited bully. Depends on the time period of my life, the person I am interacting with, and the situation I am in, and most importantly the person perceiving me at any given moment. I have terrorized and traumatized people with words, head games, and physical violence. I have spent countless hours volunteering in soup kitchens, neighborhood cleanup efforts, normally orchestrated by churches. Hey, I might not believe in their God, but I can believe in the beneficial goodness in their actions inspired by their faith. I have loaned ridiculous sums of money to people I knew would never be able to fully pay me back. I have handed $50 bills to hobos and told them buy all the crack, smack and booze they wanted. Just promised to reserve enough of that money for at least one good meal. I have done both harm and benefit to individuals and society. I don't think I am good or bad. I am both. And I think everyone is both. Feminists who disagree with my viewpoints on gender will swear that I am subhuman filth. An entitled rape apologist that wants to hurt women. I will make no effort to change their opinion of me. Their opinion is based upon you either agree with me or I vilify you. Many people thought I was a genius. And then I said I think anarchy is unworkable and downright silly. To which I became a dumb son of a bitch who doesn't know what I am talking about. Remember, I'm always a genius when I echo a thing you believe in. And always a dumb son of a bitch when I trash a thing you believe in. This is true with me and everyone. Haven't you noticed it's the smartest people in the world that agree with you, and the dumbest people that disagree? Did you think that was just a strange coincidence? It's called human ego, and the reason you'll more easily praise those who hand you feel-good lies, than those who respect you enough to tell you the harsh truth. Let that be a clue as to why the most deceitful people tend to be on top of society, and an honest man can't win an election. As I said, I do not believe in morality, at least not objective morality. Objective morality would have to have an infallible being to justify the existence of the objective moral. Otherwise, morality would be based on popular consensus. If 99% of people believe blank is immoral, then it is, because society said so. In which case morality is a fashion trend, to which wearing bell bottoms in this day and age is immoral, because it is no longer socially approved of. Germans killing Jews in the 1930s was totally moral because it was the popular cultural trend. Separate drinking fountains for blacks and whites in the 1950s was a perfectly moral value, because it was the popular one. A woman calling herself a rape victim when she regrets her consent, is moral because it's totally in vogue. And if killing the non-believers is common practice, then it must be moral now. On the topic of God as the maker of morality, first, there is no God. Trust me on this, there really isn't. Therefore your God-backed morals are immoral because they are based on a lie. Unless of course basing a system of values on a work of fiction and then pressuring others to conform to this system is somehow moral. If we examine the Christian God, he has committed genocide, murder, rape, the existence of eternal suffering. If you believe the passages that talk about gnashing of teeth, hell, fire and brimstone, damnation, as applying to all those who do not enter the kingdom of heaven, he created humans, gives them an instinctive nature to do what he calls sin, and then threatens to eternally punish them for it. Wow, what a sick fucker. An omnipotent being whose ego is so fragile he requires constant praise and worship, and is so desperate and needy he will force you to worship him under threat of eternal damnation. If God is real, which he's not, then we can say God's actions and commandments to kill firstborn, and make animal sacrifices, cannibalize thy family, and rape women and take them as wives against their will, is totally moral because it's God, and God has a special right and can make exceptions for anyone at any time, at his own whim. I find it interesting that Hitler is called evil for killing a mere 6 million people. God is perfect for killing everyone but Noah and his family. If genocide, rape, and murder are the actions of God, and God is good, then it is good to follow in the behaviors of God. If God's behavior is bad when humans do it, but good when he does it, then to be good means to be unlike God. But let's be honest, the Bible commands and forbids everything. It tells you to kill people and then tells you not to kill. It tells you to stone people and then tells you only he without sin may cast a stone, while also saying no one is without sin. Ultimately, the Bible endorses everything, and thus endorses nothing. You, the individual, pick and choose which parts of the Bible you personally identify with. You ignore, deny, and justify with whatever mental gymnastics it takes, the parts of the Bible you are not following. You will stuff your face with pork while condemning homosexuality as a sin. When all is said and done, your so-called moral system is merely your own personal opinions, being validated by your cherry-picking scripture, which now acts as an echo chamber for yourself. God is merely a code word for your own ego. And so we're right back to, a thing is moral or immoral because you say so. Now, where does morality come from? There is the notion that some things are right and some things are wrong. These concepts change from person to person, but nonetheless the very notion that a thing can be good or bad is a human thing. So where does it come from? Same place all things that are human come from. Evolution. Humans are herd animals, or maybe the term is pack animals. I really don't remember the difference in those two descriptors. Rather than being solitary hunters, humans gain an advantage by being in groupings, collectives, such as tribes, gangs, cults, society, in order for individuals to coexist. An instinct must be put into place to act as a social lubricant. In order to be a part of society, you must part with some degree of individualism. Morality is merely an empathy and guilt-based system of how to interact with others in the group. The golden rule is the best description of this behavior: do unto others as you'd wish them to do unto you. If you would not approve of someone just taking your stuff, then you yourself should not take the belongings of others. Although with some resources, it may be wiser to share, sometimes you will part with what is rightfully yours, to give to a person who is more needy. This instinct is based on investment. If you give man one of your blankets, then when you are hungry and he has additional food, he will remember your kindness and repay it. Morality is a survival instinct, as is being part of a collective. Morality is derived from collectivism. Again, in order to be part of the collective, you must make some sacrifices of your individuality. You must have with you cooperative skills. These cooperative skills involve respecting people's personal space, right of self-determination, and property rights, all the while realizing sometimes you will have to make sacrifices for the team. It is learning to put away your selfish desires and give others the respect you'd like them to have for you. It means knowing that a society, in order to function, is going to have rules, and rules mean you can't just do whatever you feel like doing. And again, the key to morality is empathy, being able to understand and identify with the needs and feelings of others, and guilt for violating others in ways you would not have liked to have been violated or cheated. It's partially about shedding some of the narcissistic skin of individualism, to make sacrifices for a team who will also shed their selfish individualism to make sacrifices for you. Morality is a social lubricant to aid in team cooperation. After all, if you are not part of a society, then you can't really commit an immoral act. If you live 1,000 miles away from others, you can't exactly kill people, because they're not there. You can't steal from people, because no one is around. You can't lie, cheat, or harm others, because there are no others. So when traditionalists want to refer to me as a nihilist, and they're typically coming from a position of conservatism and libertarianism, ergo against collectivism, it's just a hilarious contradiction. Again, morality is just a bunch of do's and don'ts of living in a collective. But the thing is, these do's and don'ts are not always agreed upon, even by well-meaning selfless individuals. There simply is no universal objective morality. At the end of the day, it really does come down to a bunch of opinions that differ from individual to individual. I also want to include that morality goes hand in hand with guilt, which brings us back to the sociopath. As I said earlier, the sociopath tends to lack guilt while exploiting it in others. Personally, this is practically the only quality I look for in a person before determining that they are a sociopath. Because when you see someone lack guilt, but try to manipulate and shame others and make them feel guilty, they will always have practically every other sociopathic trait. I seldom ever use the word sociopath, simply due to what a vague, misused, and convoluted concept it is. Also, it's too similar and often indistinguishable from psychopath, to which there are two types, that found in psychology, and that found in criminal psychology. Furthermore, psychopath, while having its origins in psychology, isn't an actual diagnosis in the DSM. The closest the DSM comes is a personality disorder called antisocial personality disorder. Psychopathy is a personality spectrum, meaning everyone has a little bit of psychopath in them, in the same way that everyone has a little bit of greed in them, a little bit of dishonesty in them, and so on. Back to the guilt. People who often attempt to shame and guilt others, tend to lack shame and guilt themselves. It is this, and this alone, in my experience, which tends to be the foundation of sociopathy. I am weary and distrusting of those who insist I am supposed to feel guilt, sorrow, or concern over something. For example, I don't have any emotion when thinking about the terrorist attack on 9/11. It didn't emotionally affect me then or now. What I distrust is the person who exploits this tragedy. A few years ago, there was a video someone did of all these beauty gurus and vloggers who were making their 9/11 commemoration video. And the person made this collection of these videos and pointed out how insincere they were being, and how lovely they had ads plastered on their videos. In other words, they were using the 9/11 tragedy as an excuse to make money, providing no real concern, no interesting insight, and just embarrassingly going through the motions to get their 5-minute video out there. To me, this is psychopathic behavior because it is emotionally exploitative and deceitful. It's one thing to not be concerned with 9/11. It's another to pretend to be concerned, and yet a whole other ball game to exploit it for cash, or use it as a political lever on political topics not relevant to the 9/11 attack. People who tell me I should feel sorrow and empathy for 9/11 strike me as manipulative people. Gee, sorry, my emotions are not governed by your personal expectations about how others ought to feel, you fucking control freak. Think you could step back and not dictate my emotions for me? Thanks. This is up there with all the won't someone think of the children, as I pointed out, and gave examples of, in a previous video. People who hide behind won't someone think of the children, are not at all concerned about children, they merely wish to control how others live their lives, and are merely hiding behind the excuse of children. This is psychopathic because it is deceitful, manipulative, and preys on the human guilt response. People who frequently make appeals to emotion are also being psychopathic because rather than trying to get through to you by means of truth and logic, they are manipulating your feelings, preying on empathy and guilt. Likewise, people who continuously insist that you share their beliefs, agree with them, support their cause, lest you be branded as immoral, are typically psychopaths. Appeals to morality is a dumb man's excuse when he has no argument. It is also an effort to say morally you have to agree with me, or you're being immoral. In closing, I am a nihilist, and I don't trust those who use the notions of morality as a crutch to prop up their weak arguments and demonize those who disagree. I believe those whose speeches rely heavily on the notion of morality are manipulative snakes that I would caution you to distrust. All communication is an effort to manipulate your actions or opinions. I speak, therefore I manipulate, but do so without deception. I make no pretense of being a good person. I will stab you in the front, not the back.